So just before the break, I love the fact that we can really once we start pushing the buttons with people who do the same thing in different areas, the networking, the flow really starts. And I think we're going to have that at lunch, and we're going to have it later, because really once people start talking, the ideas start flowing, and it's really fun. So we were looking at the different approaches here. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk you through these things, but I'm really going to focus on QCBS, because the other five approaches are fairly straightforward. Just think about it. If it's quality-based and you're selected on the basis of the quality, then they pick you, then they bust your financial, and they send everyone else's back. If it's fixed budget, you're showing how you can deliver it for a fixed budget. If you're just being picked on CQS or single source, these are more or less self-explanatory. But the idea that focusing on QCBS is important is, in Canada, typically QCBS is the rule. We would love to see another form in here in Canada, but our government doesn't even issue typically anything other than QCBS. They're not typically permitted unless you have a unique service. So I'm going to walk you through. I'm going to register you in the ADB CMS system. So ADB CMS is the consultant management system which ADB uses to operate the recruitment of consultants and goods and works. So, consultants. So what you do is you have to create and update your profile. You send in your EOIs, even the proposals on this. So in the manual, we've provided you with the guidelines for walking through the system. And once I take you there, you'll get an idea of this. So typically on the CMS, you get a consulting service recruitment notice. Now this is really good. Every Sunday night, I get this sent to me, a list of opportunities. Every Sunday night, like clockwork. I don't even have to look. They pull them up and send them to me by sector. They show me the country, whether it's an individual or a firm assignment. And as we've heard, it's not necessarily the easiest thing to use, but once you do use it, you'll find it's really valuable. So this consulting services recruitment notices provide the terms of reference, and they have to be posted and available for you to see for at least 15 for firms and 17 for companies. So you'll see this.
It's on like page 71, right?
Page 71. Page 71 in your book.
Is that what you're doing?
Yeah. So page 71 in your book includes the manual, which ADB provides on how to use the management system. Now I put this in here because that's how I learned how to use this. Is I downloaded their guides, and then I clicked through them, and it was very, very, very useful for me. So this shows you how people are engaged, how it works, who's approving, what they... Everybody find that? It looks like this.
It actually doesn't have a page, but it's just right after 78.
So each one of these has two sides to it, I should point out. So it shows you, like for example, the last slide on QCBS and QBS and stuff, it was there. And then you'll see the types of technical proposals and the limits. So the model that I'm passing around and we're going to walk through is STP, a simplified technical proposal. So SDPs are used for assignments with well-funded tours and a cost estimate ranging from $600,000 to $1 million. So the SDP can range in size from like this big to that big as the two that we're passing around. And then, or a FTP can be about this big. There's a significant discrepancy in size. And the discrepancy is
On the next one, managing consulting firm profiles. Number two is in an FTP, you have to include these profiles. In a STP, a short technical proposal, you don't. So once a project has been designed and there are opportunities available, typically they will issue a expression of interest. So when the expression of interest pops up, typically on the consulting services recruitment notice, you click on that and it'll take you to this page. It'll ask you to log in, and then you log in and it'll say, you can click the button that says declare interest. And then you have to fill in the form the way that it operates. So these are all done online. Now, a little tip here. When you first sign up, they ask you to fill in your experience. The more complete experience you fill in, the better it's going to be for you when you submit an EOI, because you have to attach these things to validate your experience. So as somebody who's logged in and out of that system about 10,000 times, it's usually because of fatigue. I was like, I'm going through, I'm putting it in. It's like over and over again. But I'll tell you, every time I did it, I found some flaw or error in my own products and services that I had used to correct, which so was invaluable. But it is tiring, and it does. You should budget, you know, some time to do it. Don't think that when you do it, you can just pass through it like so quickly that it'll be over in 10 minutes. No, it is a long and arduous process, but it is part of the system, right? So it is the way things work. So if you follow this number two guideline on doing that, it will be helpful to you. They do give you good and helpful tips. Now, there's another reason for doing it well. And the reason is other people can see it. Other potential partners, other ADB officers, people who are recruiting, click on your profile, your experience, your background, and say, I want to work with those guys. They have what I need. But if you have nothing there, then they go, I don't even see them. They're not even there. You're invisible. So registering can get you recruited, by the way, can get you shortlisted, can get you in the game. If you don't register and you don't put your stuff there, then you have zero opportunity with the Asian Development Bank, by the way. Like absolutely zero. Because there is a provision for putting things in by paper. But I don't know if that system actually works. I haven't done anything that way in a long time. Usually it's the proposal you submit by paper if you have to, but typically if they'll accept it electronically, why would you? I mean, electronic submissions are a demonstration of capacity and capability too. If you can't pack it up on your computer, then just because you can print it up doesn't mean anything. And I will give you a bit of a reflection here is having worked on a proposal, which was, I can't even speak of the loss that I suffered because my partner didn't deliver the bid on time. So it got held up in Jamaican customs, the rare opportunity that I get to work in a place that's considered safe and non-conflictual. They delivered it on time, but it didn't get out of customs in time and it arrived a day late and it was disqualified. So if they had, the European Union wanted it in paper, you better be able to deliver it the way the client wants it. If they want it electronically, deliver it electronically. If they want it in paper, I mean, if, in those circumstances, I offered to deliver it by hand. You know, I could get it down there in 3 hours and hand it over, you know, but people are people. So follow the rules, follow the guidelines, follow the model, follow the process, follow the instructions. If you do what they instruct you to, you'll be okay. So completing these firms' references is really important. So if you look at that guidebook number two, you need to understand that. So just to help you a little bit more, what I did is I put one of mine in there, and I'm going to show it to you. I'm going to move a little bit quicker because I want to get into preparing a proposal. Like, I want to actually, in an hour, run you through the preparation of one of these things. So first, I'm just going to whip through the system here. I didn't invent the system. I just used the system. So if we look at this right here, how do you pre-qualify? How do you get on the shortlist? Because you can't compete unless you get shortlisted. How do you get shortlisted? Well, you have to look at what is the criteria. This is just an example here. You either are eligible or not eligible. You either have the financial capacity or you don't. Okay, if you can't answer the yes and no, there's a reason it's yes or no. If it's no, go do something else. Then it's your background, similar work, similar countries, language, and the use of local consultants. So you can see that if you don't have any local consultants, that range may go up or it may go down. Again, the weighting is typically like this. Experience of the firm measures your demonstrated. This is an important word, is demonstrated experience. The personnel, the amount of people you have and what you can offer. So what kind of backstopping? If you're just a single firm with one person, what kind of backstopping do you have? But if you're a university with an entire faculty backstopping it, even though you're not charging it, it gives a client confidence when they look at that. Or if you're an engineering firm with 13 offices or 20 offices, it's the kind of backstopping you offer. And how you manage. Firms that offer integrated electronic services and invoicing and production capacity through remote technology that can be delivered in various capacities that are technologically relevant, those are the ones that get shortlisted. You see, when you do this for a long time, the words come out of your mouth like a proposal, eh? I'm a writer by trade. So let's have another look at another one. I spend a little bit of time on pre-qual, so you understand. These slides are all on your USB card. So the firm, demonstrate, sample, your in-house, your alliances, your associates, your understanding of the project, your solvency. I'm not going to talk much about letters of credit and stuff like that, because if you're going to globally compete, then you better be solvent. But we can give you a list of people who are insolvent if you need them. And we can also give you a list of blacklisted people. We can point you to it. As I said it yesterday, this is the first thing you should look at. Don't associate with anyone who's been blacklisted. Do not. It is like all of a sudden you've done nothing wrong. Now you've been toxically exposed to chemical waste. I don't want to put it that way, but man, you've done nothing wrong until you didn't do your due diligence. So do your due diligence all the time. So let's look at one of these profiles that gets you shortlisted. It's usually one or two pages. The reason it's one or two pages is you only have so much room on that electronic database to input the information. So I write long ones, and then I write short ones. And then I cull what I need from the short ones, and then I input them into the thing, and then I edit them in there, and then I save repeatedly, because if I don't, you get kicked out every 15 minutes. Save repeatedly. Did I say save repeatedly? So actually, if you do this properly, you're basically getting yourself in position to be shortlisted by demonstrating, because you don't get to talk. I'm a really good talker, but I don't get to talk, so I have to write it down. Like, I have to prove it. So when you look at this, you have to organize it in the way that you input it. The name, the country location, the client. You have the client's information. The longer we get into this, the more detailed information they keep asking for. Like, I first started out with their name, then it started out with their address, then it was their phone number. Now they want their email address. The last one I did, I had to have every single assignment that I had on my CV signed. signed. And I was like, do you know how long it took me to go back 20 years and get everything signed? So then I'm shooting out ones that I couldn't get signed, or I had to prepare a document that had them signed. Now, not everybody wants that, but it shocked me that they wanted that kind of evidence signed off on. And what it was a gatekeeper thing. They basically said, if you can't even get your own experience on your own CV signed, then we're just gatekeeping you out. Like, not everybody wanted that, but then I got it signed, and now you bet I carry that around with me everywhere I go now. I don't need anything else now. They did me a favor, a huge favor, like personally. So I didn't mind going through it, right? So there's lots of these profiles. I can give you a list of my assignments where I was assigned to other firms to help them prepare this. You would believe how many firms don't have this ready. You have to have this ready. And if you're not ready, then you're not ready to bid. Even if it's an FTP and you have to produce it on paper, if you have to spend your time writing this now, you're not ready. So I strongly encourage you to do an inventory of everything you have. So they ask you who was involved in that project. What was their name? What was their job? What was their experience? If they're because remember, they're not another firm is not allowed to appropriate that person's experience on their stuff just because they're working for them now. It's still yours. And those people have to show that they were working for you when they did that. So this is a very, very important and tactical thing when you're preparing these things. So they typically, on the ADB, it looks like this. So, you know, the duration, the assignment, the name of the client, the approximate value, in US dollar or euro, not Canadian dollar. So you have to use a relevant transactional equivalency on this. So I believe we have a model in the workbook.
It sits on page 37.
Now, the funny thing is, and I love the conversation we had yesterday about standardized versus non-standardized, the banks got together in 2011, made all the standard forms for everybody, then they decided to unstandardize them. I was like, what? Okay, so I have to have my profiles ready in three different formats. I have them ready in ADB format, in Global Affairs format, which is totally different because they ask for results at the bottom and they want you to transmit it. And then in World Bank format, which recently changed as well. So, I mean, it's all basically the same kind of information, but it's all about sorting. It's all about sorting. So you have to have, like on page 36, a brief profile of yourself, and then you have to have a summary of the project profile of the firm, which sorts it out, and you have to show the key personnel. For privacy reasons, I blocked out some people. So I put two models in there.
One involved
the firm, and the second involved two of us going to Yemen and working on loan design. So the first case model was we were doing implementation and part of the work supporting the client. And the second one, we were working with the bank task team and the client and preparing the project documents and the project appraisal and the loan. So the information contained in there should be relevant, succinct, and should address those points that are on the profile. Because once you've done that, you might have to change it on a full technical. Because sometimes they ask you to relate your experience in the full technical exactly in the profile to it. So you might have to tweak it. That's why I have the long ones that might be 4 or 5 pages. So I can pull what I need. So typically, as you saw from the model that I was passing around there, there's 4 or 5 firms. There's usually never more than 2 from a single country. If there is, there's a pretty strong message there that country is sort of the target, you know. So you should really pay attention to who's shortlisted. It really, just because you get shortlisted doesn't mean you should necessarily bid. But as we heard yesterday, if you don't decide to bid and you get shortlisted, remember, this all comes in electronically, so it might pop up on your dashboard you've been shortlisted. Like, it might pop up there, and you might get an email. So you've got to check your dashboard after you submit EOIs. But traditionally, we're seeing something that we didn't see a long time ago, which was one firm from a developing country, which it's not all, and sometimes it might be two or three. You know, it's. And I would just hazard to say there are no rules anymore regarding to this. Yes, Michael.
So those requirements under the new banks regulations are gone. It's now no longer a requirement for a consultant from a host country or no more than two from one country.
Okay. Those requirements are gone.
And that's the World Bank. In ADB, they haven't changed yet.
In ADB, they haven't changed. No. So going back a slide here. The requirements were that there would be no more than two firms from any one nationality, and that at least one firm would be from a developing country. Now, at the bank, those requirements have been removed, but at ADB, they have not.
So Michael, you could have theoretically all Canadians in a particular bid now.
Correct, yeah.
And that's the quality comment that you made yesterday, the idea of having the best quality consultants or suppliers.
That's right. I mean, you were getting situations where there wasn't a consultant available from a developing country. So, we've removed those requirements.
I have another model where I was reluctant to pass around, but I'm going to pass it around.
I'm not even going to pass it around. I'm going to hold it up, Kathleen.
It has one company on it, and it's German. Okay. So this was accepted by ADB, and maybe you could explain why.
Okay. Again, these are guidelines. If you've got a good business case, and in that case it might have been that the expressions of interest, is this the EOI shortlisted?
Yes, this is for GIZ, GTZ.
GTZ. Okay. GTZ is slightly different than a German company. GTZ is the government of Germany's a branch of CEDA, basically. So they do development work, and it was quite possibly a sole selection that would have gone through a process prior where there was a sufficient business case. Say GTZ does a lot. I know they did a lot of work in anti-corruption in Indonesia, for example. So if I'm going to do an anti-corruption project in Indonesia, they would also bring co-financing from the German government, so GTZ might actually be given the contract. It is not typical. But these are guidelines, and mission leaders or task team officers have the opportunity to make a business case if there is, for example, not a consulting firm in this particular area from a developed country. First and foremost, you want 5 to 6 firms that have the capacity to do the work. We don't shortlist just because we want 5 or 6. We want 5 to 6 good quality proposals because we want the best consultants for the job. So it's not just shortlisting for the sake of shortlisting, and if you can't find it, you can go back to the powers that be and make a business case why it should be one firm, why it should be 3 firms, why it could be 3 Canadian firms. But this is the starting point.
Thank you. So generally speaking, Vicky. I don't know if I have a mic to pass through. but yeah, we could just come up. Yeah. So it's really hard to get shortlisted. But I will tell you, once you get shortlisted, you can do it again. And again and again and again. But don't expect just because you got shortlisted, you'll be shortlisted again. And don't expect because you won a project, you're going to win again either. It's like training. You keep training. You keep making your products better. You keep going back. And a lot of the help that I give firms is they forget about their history. They they forget what happened 5 years ago. If you don't write it down, words kind of blow away in the wind, you know? So taking a proper inventory and recording of your firm and yourself is really important, like in a CV. You don't want to be looking backwards and thinking all the time. But really, it's they're generally interested in the last 5 or 10 years. The last 5 or 10 years is the most relevant. Typically, you're not getting to input stuff from 20 years ago because it's not relevant. So you focus on the last 5 or 10, but whatever, I always encourage people, whenever you do something, write it down, take a record of it, you know, record it, and then it'll always be useful for you. So when you get the RFP, that's why we're passing it around, you see a letter of invitation, a data sheet, the terms of reference, and a draft contract. So on your USB and in the book there, we put the samples of this, but these are the samples provided by the banks with blanks in them. So you can see how the bank picks, as we heard, insert here. So how do you respond? Okay, so what's on these forms? So on the letter, it shows who else is shortlisted. So you have to take an inventory of your competition. What are the instructions? So it tells you how much is there. And then it tells you what the evaluation criteria is. I always look at that. That's really important to me. Like how much weighting is being given. The weighting is not always the same. The weighting is adjusted by the person who's preparing this. But there's a range they're operating in, but typically the weighting is there. So in the guidebook, the one that had the how to prepare the profiles. Guidebook number 4 is helpful with the CMS on how to prepare a technical proposal. How to input it, I should say. So typically, these are what they call IFI standard forms. Tech 1, Tech 2, Tech 3, Tech 4, Tech 5, Tech 6. Now, as I was putting this together, I noted that sometimes Tech 5 can be Tech 6. And sometimes Tech 6 can be something else. Like, for example, it could be the anti-corruption declaration. So then I started to produce in the manual tech blank, okay? Because they're not always, tech one and tech two, they're not always, the number's not always the same. So like, for example, in a short technical proposal, you might not see tech two because you don't need to have it. It's already included. But typically, those are the forms. So we have a sample of the form in the manual, which I'm gonna walk you through in a minute. And then the evaluation typically looks like this. Who are the people? The quality of expertise and the skills offered. And I can say with great confidence now that approximately 40 to 50% of the value of every proposal, sometimes even more, is on the people. So when I look around the room at the quality of the people in the room and their experience, I say, you have a lot of ability to compete in the global market because the quality of the personnel is that amount, that much. Its value is that much. So if you know how good you are in your experience and the people around you, then you have half of what you need. So let's start thinking about it that way. Do we have it packaged so that we can present that we have half of what we need right now? Do you have it? Now, your approach and methodology. We used to spend almost all our time on that. I mean, I run bid teams big and small. I used to have like a 10-person bid team. I have 3 people working on CVs in a proposal that needed 20 or 30 people. I'd have 1 or 2 people working on methodology. But by God, they would probably spend more time than all those other people combined. And it was only worth like 10 points or 12 points. Now, functionally speaking, if the terms of reference are at that level of detail, how much creativity do you think you have to room to maneuver? You're going to make a point or 2 out of 10. That's what you're going to get. So this is about maximizing your level of effort and inputs into the winning formula. So if you spend that much time on this thing that's going to get you 1 point, you better be thinking, I'm only going to win by 1 point. Right? Why not spend more time, especially if you're delivering services on the people, on shaving the CVs and like a fine piece of woodwork into something that can magically turn into one of those ducks that would trick all the other ducks into coming around. Right? Like that's what you want to do. You want to create yourself a product that is incomparable in nature, that makes you irreplaceable and invaluable. Coming from a, of course, very modest country of modest people, you're reticent to present your magical duck to them, but you must present it with flowing colors, and that color might just be you. So when you do that, you make sure you do it well, and you make sure that you make your people look better than everyone else, because somebody else is out there doing exactly the same thing. And then you have to line it all up with these charts that show those ducks floating on a water pond and ending up in a place where they're not getting gunned down by some hunters, but they're doing something that no other duck can do. And you have to do it with value for money. Now, if that's not tricky enough, then I'll have to show you one of my charts. So, the letter is the template. Read the letter, it's one or two pages. You just saw a model that says, we're pleased to instruct you. We won't spend much time on that, but maybe don't skip by the letter. As Sir said yesterday, read every single word on that document. Then there are these instructions to the consultant and the data sheet. So if you look at
the data sheet. Sorry,
page 21.
Page 21 has a blank data sheet on it. So this is one of those standard forms where it says insert here. So you see on page 21 it says choose. On page 23, either. Page 22, 23, full, simplified, biodata, yes or no. So this is the form that their IFIs are typically using when they complete the data sheet. The data sheet is the most important thing, and it overrides everything else. So you really have to pay attention to this data sheet. So the reason I included the blank sheet here was so you could see how they're building them. Then when you see a regular data sheet, when you come across one, you'll understand how it was built. So basically, if you see something contradictory in the document and that conflicts with this data sheet, it's the data sheet overrides everything else.
But that's usually
when I ask a question, by the way, because I don't like it when it says something different in any part of the document. It means that there was a mistake made, an error of omission, and at the If I'm competing in a global market, then I would expect that the people who are running the global market shouldn't be making errors of omission. And the point is to request clarification. And they do promptly say, oh, this is it, right there. So this helps you prepare your proposal. It tells you the kind of proposal you have to prepare, and it tells you what you have to do in it. So, on this sheet here, you'll see the general, the difference between a full, a short, and a biodata technical proposal. Now, the full is, there's a check mark in every box. Full means full. It doesn't mean like you had a really good dinner last night. It means like you have to do everything. So you have to break down the whole proposal and you have to address every single component in the proposal. Every line, everything has to be done. That's why they typically come much larger than the other ones. Whereas a STP can be this big, a full can be this big, it can be multiple volumes, depending on the size. So when we look at that, it's important to note the differences. So in the full, you'll see you have to provide the submission form, profiles, overview, comments on the terms of reference, the methodology, the schedule, the components, the whole deal. There's not a lot of the not a lot are asking for the full now. But the evaluation on this is somewhat different. So when we look at the full, it's typically 100 to 200 points for your qualifications. Now, just think, like in a short, you've already been qualified. So those 200 points aren't a factor. So that's why we're more emphasizing the personnel, because that part you don't get that experience. So what I found is that in the qualification portion, that really is a gatekeeping thing too. It gets firms tossed out. Like if you don't get full points on that, then you know, they shortlisted you to see if you could make up for it. So it's very difficult to make up points on that. Like if you're losing 20 or 40 points on that, then how are you going to make it up, you know, in a QCPS situation? It means you had to be ahead by 100 in some other area, which is very difficult. It is simplified. You just have to prepare the form, your approach, your schedule, and your team. So you can see the people are worth 70% of the technical on this. So 70% of 80%. It's around 60%. You know, 60% of the value on the people. That's why we spend a lot of time working on our CVs. A lot of time. So we don't have to work on them for too much when the proposals come up. We just kind of craft them for the proposal. And I hate working on CVs. I absolutely despise it. I've trained so many people to do it now, but I personally consider it an art. People who can do this thing, they have a rare talent, like a specific skill that should be really valued in a way that people don't understand. If they're basically winning for you. I mean, these are people, and while I've been able to do it and train people, it is certainly not where my skill lies. My skill lies in the part that they only give 10% for now. I don't know what I'm going to do with my life. Because really, unless I'm working on those things in the financial parts, then it's much harder, you know? So you have to keep retooling yourself for the market, right? So training people to do that, and it's usually people who have a lot of energy, a lot of skill, people who can organize things into the aspects. And we build a matrix and a chart that lines up the things that they're looking for. And we give points to each portion of that. We subpoint the CV, because as you'll see, that's what the evaluators do too. So if you don't know how this works, then it's very difficult to understand the importance of it, right? So typically, people, when they first start doing it, they're looking at the methodology. They're saying, our approach is the only approach that will work. No, that's not true. That's not true at all. So then when you look at these things, you then understand why the CV is so important. So if you look at page 31 in the workbook, there's a blank terms of reference, just like there's a blank data sheet. And again, the terms of reference are filled in generally the same way. And if you go to page 33, I'm not going to spend much time in terms of reference, because they basically tell you what you have to do, and you have to respond to them. So the technical submission form, again, here's page 33, has the blank form. It basically says, this is what you fill this in. Funny story, they give you the blank now, because so many people submitting the proposals have managed to screw up this letter. They say type over this. Do not recreate the form. That's actually the recommendation now. Do not recreate this form. Just type inside the form when they give it to you. I have the rare benefit of the experience of being disqualified for just about every particular way you could. The 90s were a very difficult period. So once it said we put H instead of I on top of the four. That was the day they got rid of H and I. It's crazy. So then we look at the approach of methodology. So this is where you demonstrate. Yeah, let's go on that. Because I already did that. If we go to page 43. I apologize for the size of the book, but I was trying to leave you with a giant tool that you could take home and look at. And I think that's part of the understanding. So you don't have to look for it yourself. You know, that's why it's on the chip. And I think if you follow the links, it will be helpful. I mean, just putting it together, I learned more stuff. You know, the part of the learning process is understanding that these are built on these templates. So if you look at the template, the instructions are given to the guys who prepare the template. So demonstrate your understanding of the objectives, the assignment, the approach to services, the methodology for carrying out. Highlight the problems. So there was a point here about development, about how much room you have to talk about development. You don't have a lot of room, but you do have to address what the challenge is. Like, for example, water supply, energy, access to education, chronic poverty, underlying impediments to economic growth. These are all things that you have to tie into this. Now, then you have to prepare your work plan. So when you look at the work plan, you have to say, prepare the assignments. The proposed work plan should be consistent with the tours, and the schedule has to be consistent with the form. So if you look on page 44 of the workbook, you'll see the blank schedule. So they typically give you a blank schedule. Now look at page 45, and you'll see a sample schedule here that I use. This is a winner. That's a winner. And on page 46 is another winner. These are sample schedules. So you have to basically propose the activities. You break it down, and what we do is we code them with numbers and letters, so that we can triangulate it on the other forms. So you see how they're coded, and they with bar charts, and then at the end here it says who's doing it on the end, the assignment here, and it has to conform to the chart, and then it has to conform to the work program, so that you can see exactly how you're. The client wants to see who's doing it over here, how they're doing it, what they're doing, when they're doing it. So that has to be captured in one single chart, and then it has to be transposed onto another chart in, of course, a different form. So this is where the organization and staffing come in. So if you look at page 47, we've got a blank chart. And then if you flip it over, you see a sample tech 2 here. And again, the totals of international and domestic consultants, the work plan and the bar chart, then if you look at 49, you'll see another sample here of the people. And what they're specialized in, their country of origin, their name, their firm. I cannot guarantee that these forms won't change, but these are samples. These are examples of exactly what you have to do. Now, there's a very good reason for showing you these, and the blanks, because you have to fill them in. So feel free to fill them in the same way I filled them in, or any way you want to fill them in, but you got to fill them in. So it's like, don't change the chart, I guess is the moral of the story. They give you the chart, you fill in the chart. They ask you to fill in the name, you fill in the name. They ask you to fill in the country, you fill in the country. They ask you how much time, you fill in how much time. It's not like rocket science. You do it or you get zero. So There's a certain logic to that I probably don't need to go into. So on a short technical, you're only given 10 pages to do this. 10 pages. How do you do that in 10 pages? There's only one answer. It's really well. So you have to do less work, but you have to do it much tighter. So you don't really have much room to maneuver. So you learn how to write in small bursts, like a paragraph. So if it's the agro-food specialist, burst about the agri-food. If it's the team leader, burst about the team leader. Like burst out all the information, refer to the number of the letter in the chart. In B1, X3, quarter, four. You know, the recipient client is used to receiving the information in such a manner, but coding is very, very important. Coding shows that you know a level of sophistication that can interface between the Excel charts, between the Microsoft project chart, between the Gantt and the organizational staffing chart, and the money. So then when we get to the financial schedules, you see the coding enables you to tie it all together. So when we're doing it, we can move seamlessly between the charts and the text. And if you use Microsoft Project, you can harness that energy to attach them as bolted to the sides of them. I may have gotten ahead of myself. Oh, there's that chart that I spoke of. So in STPs, they ask you for this form. And I noted that some of the RFPs don't ask for this form, but some do. So I wanted to show this one here where they, like, ask you for the composition, the assignment, and the key expert inputs on one chart. So after I had to do that for one, I started to use this chart for other things to help me collect the information. So I thought that was a very interesting chart just to demonstrate data collection. Now, if you look at that chart that has composition, assignment, and inputs, and then you juxtapose it to this chart, which is simply a work schedule and only contains, you know, a much more limited amount of information. So if you start with preparing a chart like this, you can then start to take the information out, just like when we start the organizational profile. If you have a long one and you start to draw the information out, you know? So master charts, master profiles enable you to create a master database in terms of proposal preparation. Well, let's just say that you're only given, 30 days to prepare the proposal. It's not a lot of time, right? And 30 days means 30 days. So then if you look at this chart here, which is labeled Tech 5, this one here, which is Tech 3, that other chart, which was Tech 2, combines Tech 3 and 5. So really, what you can do is you can build yourself a nice little tool here by putting these three that I just showed in a row there, Tech 2, Tech 3, Tech 5, you roll them up together, and once you build yourself a model, you have yourself a platform for doing these kinds of bits. And if you combine that with your organizational profiles, you know, your experience, your firm's experience, and your personnel, this is the heart right here of how your bid operates. You know, so this experience that you're going through in terms of packaging that stuff is really important. Any questions on that? This is usually part of the workshop where everyone's stunned. What does the chart, who's making charts like that? Oh, go ahead.
I have a resume system with a list of requirements, and there's a resume
Yeah, it's a good question. So the question is, do you have to prove that you met this criteria, who the reference is, the consultant's reference is? Well, on the assignments, on your organizational profile, you're given more points if the people in the bid are also in the profile. And in the profile, you have to show who the reference is. And you have to point out their contact information as well, like how to get in touch with them. And
no, what I mean is, in government procurement, for example, they ask for a project for a team of three people.
Yeah.
And they ask for example, experience of managing large project exceed $10 million. And they want to see reference, like you bring two people, and this personnel have actually done this kind of project. So you actually quote in a way
Oh yeah, I'm going to address that right now.
Okay.
That's how good that question was. It's on the next slide. Are there any questions on the previous slides? I know it's a lot, but I think it's really important to think about it like this. You write a methodology. You say the team leader is going to do this. Then you say she is going to do this for 3 months. Then they're asking you, which 3 months? You know. So then you have to plot it on the continuum. Then if you say that she is going to do it with the curriculum specialist, then you have to show when the curriculum specialist is going to do it with the team leader. And it works kind of like that. Then you have to show, where are they going to do it? Are they going to do it in the field, or are they going to do it remotely? So this is really important, and you'll see in a minute when we get to financial. If you do it at home, you don't have reimbursable expenses. And before, there was a lot of emphasis on having people in the field. Now, there's kind of a different philosophy that there's a lot of work you can do from your desk at a much cheaper cost. So the balanced delivery schedule, it really depends on the terms of reference. Wow, I don't think I've ever done that thank you, without having a question.
One. No, sorry. CV side of things. Is it the expectation that if you were to put in CVs for a team, building experience and such, that if you were the winner, that if you put Jane Smith, bad example, but that it was actually Jane Smith that shows up at the end of the day, or somebody with a different experience?
Well, this is a poignant and technically accurate question. I mean, you should never put in anyone you don't plan on deploying. It has to be that person. And if you don't, it remains, you have to, you enter into a negotiation process that it's not predictable what the outcome could be. The client asks them to sign a form, which I'm going to show you in a minute. It says they'll be available. And if the client decides within that time of availability and you haven't provided that person, then there's a problem. And you could have just put them in there to win, which is not looked on favorably. You better have a reason for their non-availability. And I think with the EU, anyways, you have to say what other jobs you're on right now. Like,
you got sucked into another project.
Yeah, well... But I'll tell you, when I filled in the EU thing and I put down that I was down for recently in Bangladesh as a team leader on assignment, they wrote me back. They go, we don't care about anybody else but the European Union. And I go, oh, European Union. They really don't care. I wrote it all down. They go, we don't really care about anyone else but us. And I go, I knew that. I just didn't want you to say it. You know, it seems so bad, you know, because I wrote ADB, blah, blah, blah. They don't care. Because I signed the form, right? But for them, it was only the form that they had signed for them. ADB does not look at it the same way. It says, you fill out this form, you're available. And then if they're not available, you have to say why they're not available, and you have to replace them with an equivalent or better consultant at the same or lower rate. It's because in the past, people have done that and replaced them with an inferior at a higher rate, which is...
Can I just...
Can you come up, please?
Yeah.
Sorry.
this was one of
This was actually one of the points that I was going to raise. You do not want to be known as a firm that employs the bait and switch. You simply do not want. Once in a while, it might happen. But remember, each consultancy, at the end of it, whether as an individual or a firm, you will be evaluated. And that evaluation will be in the ADB system, at least. I'm sure the World Bank has a consultant evaluation as well. ADB is also a little smaller than the World Bank, and I would always look at those evaluations and immediately phone my friends who I knew had hired the consultants and said, okay, that's what you put on paper, really. Were these guys worth working for? And so if you get that reputation of bait and switch, we all know there's three or four particularly, I won't name them and I won't name what countries they come from, but they are on the watch list, and more often than not, they will also be flagged as risks for integrity violations because it is seen as an indication of the business integrity with which you conduct yourself. And when they show, the other thing is when you've got them, when you've won, they better show up in the field. Because there was actually a very large American consulting engineering firm that we barred for 5 years from ADB because they had a bunch of local consultants on the roster that never showed up. They billed for them, they didn't know they weren't showing up, and sometimes you find out those people don't even exist. So again, on the due diligence, you're going to be asked to not only put your own direct consultants, but your subcontractors and your local partners, and we expect them to be in the field and the days that they're in the field working and have the capacity to do the job. And if you're a lead firm and they don't, as a mission leader, I used to phone the head of the lead firm and say, get them out and get them out now. My $500 million project's going to be screwed up if this individual doesn't perform. So you have to have that ability. And the more that you can do that, the better, the more contracts you will get. That would be flagged in the TOR, right? I mean, I've done ones where I care more about the methodology than the people. So I don't care if you're sending 3 people, 5 people, 10 people. I want to know I want to buy your methodology, and I care about your output. The CV will specify it. But if the CV says you need an environment specialist and a gender specialist at an international level and an international financial management specialist, you need to provide those. Sometimes the CV will say which should be the lead. You know, like sometimes the CV says you support, you just identify which of your team will also be the team leader. Because we do give flexibility to the firms to say who's got the best management skills of the team, for example. But it should be very clearly identified. If it isn't, as Hussein said, you ask for clarification. And any clarification that you request will be shared with all other people that are on the show.